Yep.
Okay. Yeah, let's make a wee functional programming language. Might be fun, and it's a lovely thing to do in ACTA, because we can do something really rather nice. So, how is it going to work? We're going to build expressions in our wee programming language, or terms. So that's why I've got this type term. And those expressions might have variables in them. And expressions will also have a type. So what have I done? I've written down an inductive data type of the types that I'm going to put in this wee programming language. I haven't necessarily committed to this, but it's a good start anyway. We'll have function types. We'll have lists with an element type. And we'll have, as a base case, the unit type. So, in particular, if we want numbers, that's just lists of unit. But we can have lists of functions and lists of lists and all of that stuff. Okay, might throw some more in at some stage, but we'll start there. Okay, so what do we need to know to build programs that make sense? Well, we're going to care about what type of program we're building, and we're going to need to know which variables are in scope. So the way I'm going to describe, and what's more, we don't just need to know which variables are in scope, we need to know what all their types are. So there's going to be a finite number of variables in scope, and we need to know each of their types. So we might as well have just a list of those types. That's enough. If we have a list of types, that's enough to determine how many variables there are and what all their types are. Yeah? Okay. And by convention, the data structure that describes the variable, everything you need to know about the variables in scope, that data structure is usually called the context. And it is conventional that contexts, when they grow on their right-hand end. So that's why I've introduced this type of backwards lists. So you can see, backwards lists are quite a lot like forwards lists, except that where the forward list have a cons constructor that glues a new element on the left, the backwards lists have a constructor which glues an element on the right. And by convention, that constructor is referred to as snuck, because snuck is cons backwards. And I write it as minus comma rather than comma minus to remind you which side of the operator the long bit is. Yeah? Okay. So step one is to figure out how to represent variables. When we see them in terms. So we've got this list. Oh, I should also explain. My convention is that when you work with forwards lists, you often use variable names ending in S. Well, when I have backwards lists, I like to use variable names ending in Z, because Z is S backwards, sort of. So we've got this backwards list T's the types of the variables in scope, And representing a variable is achievable in lots of ways, but one way to do it is to choose one of the variables that is in scope. And remember, way back in exercise one, we had a type that looked a lot like this type of effectively binomial coefficients that were about explaining how to choose some number from, you know, how to choose three things from five and that sort of thing, just by saying, you know, skip this one, keep that one, and so on until you run out. Where you can play exactly the same game with lists. So here I'm saying, how do we select a sublist X from a big list Y's? And it's the same constructor she had before. There's an empty thing that says you can select the empty sublist from the empty list. And then each time the superlist has an extra element, you have to decide whether you want that one or not. So there's a successor constructor that says, yes, we are going to include Y in the sublist, and then we'll have a choice from the rest. And there's this this O apostrophe constructor, which says, no, we're not going to include Y, we're just going to select X's from Y's. Yeah? So, is this making sense? We did it with numbers before, but numbers are just boring lists. Now we've got lists that are actually interesting. So, to say that some X is an element of some backward list, it's enough to explain how to select a sublist which happens to consist of just that element from the main list. Now, you might wonder why I bother to introduce choosing multiple things from a list and then immediately take the special case where I just choose one thing. But that generality will come in handy later. So I've, you know, played this game before. In general, one of these things, we call them thinnings, and it's a way of explaining how a scope which contains some variables embeds in a larger scope which contains at least those variables, but maybe some others inserted as well. So this is the mapping. This is a mapping between two scopes that shows that all the variables in the old scope are somewhere in the new scope. In the same order, but not necessarily contiguous. Okay. So now we can say, if you want to represent a variable in a term, a variable of type T, it's enough to find one variable of type T in the context. And the good news here is that we can't screw up. We can't pick a variable that's the wrong type. We're really checking that the variable we're choosing has the type we want. Okay, so let's think about what other stuff we ought to put in our language. Let's start easy. If we're going to have the type 1 in our language, we probably ought to expect it to have one value in it. There's going to be a constructor for that. Okay? So I'll make use of the fact that Agda lets you overload constructors to use the same symbol we've been using all this time. So that's going to make a term in any context of type 1. Okay? So you can see what I'm doing is enforcing that you can only use this constructor if the type that you want is 1. Which is just as well. I'm trying to rule out type errors even from the syntax of the term. Okay. How about lists? Well, we'll probably want some constructors. So we can say that there's going to be a thing called nil, which for all t in time makes a term in any context of type list of t. And we can have a thing called cons, which for any type t takes a term of type t and a term of type list of t and gives us a term of type list of t. Okay? So does that seem like a good recipe for making a term of type list of t with a cons? The head should have type t and the tail should have type list of t. So we're really writing down the rules for being well typed at the same time as we're writing down the syntax in the first place. Okay. Any suggestions for, this is like telling us how we can build lists, but our language should let us compute with lists as well, don't you think? What would be a good way to be allowed to compute with lists? Yeah, you want to be able to take them apart and to get the head and the tail. They don't always have a head, so we might want to make sure we're at least sort of doing something with multiple cases. We also might want to be able to do some kind of recursion over lists. Like if we wanted to be able to write, you know, append or something like that. So we need something that splits lists into a nil case and a cons case and maybe allows recursion. So there's a bunch of ways we can do that. One way to do it is to give something like foldar. If we have foldar for lists, we can write a lot of list programs. So let's just put foldar into our language. We'll need two types, S and T. Let's see if we can remember what you have to give for foldar. So we're going to end up making a term of type T, and we're going to compute it from a term of type list of S. But what else should we give?
The way of computing.
Yeah, we need to give a step case and a base case. So we'll need to give a term of type S to T to T, which reminds me, I should make arrow write associative. And we'll need to give a base case which says what t we give back for the empty list. Okay. So we've got, do we need to give any operations that tell us how to make use of a value in the unit type. We never care what that value is, right? So we don't need any operations to help us look at it. So that's to say, the unit type has a way of introducing values, but no way of eliminating values. And here for lists, we've got two ways to introduce values, and we've got a way of eliminating values, a way of using them, which has two cases corresponding to the two ways of introducing values. So that's always the way that the elimination behavior should in some sense be in harmony with the introduction behavior. You've got these different ways of making stuff, and then you need something that says, we can handle the different ways it could have been made. Okay. Now, how about functions? How do we make functions? What's your rock bottom way of making functions? Well, that's a particular function, but just in terms of programming language syntax, if you just want to shove in a value or functional type, we have lambda. So we'll be in the business of making a term in some context of type SROT. But what do we need to give? What's a lambda like?
It has binding and body.
Yeah, it has a binding and a body. That's to say that in the body, there's a new variable in scope. Now here we are representing variables just by collecting how many there are and what their types are, rather than giving them names. This is really kind of a pointer to the variable that we need. So we could say the body of the binder, the body of a lambda, is going to have type T, but its context is going to have all of the old stuff, but also a new variable of type S. So there's now one more variable in scope than there was before. Okay. How do we use functions? Application. So let's write that down too. I call it infix dollar. I want to be have. Well, we're going to deliver a term of type T, and we're going to need a function of type st. Don't want an arrow there, don't want an arrow there. And an argument of type s. What have we done? Oh, I've got multiple arrows. There already is a dollar. Okay, I'll call it double dollar. Right, and then I'll make that web associative. Okay. So here we have a little programming language. It's got functions, it's got lists. We could give it pairs as well if we felt like it, but not just yet. And we've been able to write down a data type that represents the syntax of programs, but not only that, we've insisted that all of the variables used must be in scope, and all of the pieces must fit together according to some sort of type system. That's to say, we've written the syntax and the type system down at the same time in a way which hopefully means everything will come together properly. Okay. So now let's write an interpreter for this programming language. Okay. So, step one, if we know the syntax of the type, of a type in our programming language, we should say what AGD type might be good for representing values in that programming language. So we can say, I'm going to interpret values. I'm going to say for a given type, let's start the key words to use here to avoid getting confused are object and meta, right? The language we are implementing is the object language. The language that's, I don't have a name for this language. Well, I do, it's called the simply typed lambda calculus with lists and unit. The language that we are using to do the implementation is the meta language. The meta language is AGDA. So our step here is to say how to interpret object language types as meta language types. That would be the right sort of thing for representing values. Okay, so we can do that by recursion on types because object language types are just data. It's not meant to be rocket science. A good type for representing the values in object level 1 would be what? 1! What do you think lives in a value of a list type?
List of a value.
A list of values! And how do you think we should represent a value in a function type? As a function! So there we are. We've given the semantics of types just by saying this AGD type is good enough to represent the underlying stuff that we want to make use of. Okay, now let's think about how to write an interpreter. Now that we know what values are, we're going to want to write something called eval. Maybe we can just have a go. For all t's in backward in a list of types and t in tie, let's see if we can interpret a term in context t of type t as a value for type t. I'll use little t to stand for the term. Okay, split that into cases, and we get a whole bunch of cases. Okay, let's look at the first one. We've got a variable, and its type says, I know how to select just type T from the context. And we're being asked for a value of type T. But here's a tiny little snag. In order to evaluate the variables, we kind of need some extra information. How can we give back the value of a variable unless we know the values of all the variables. So we're going to need some extra information. That's to say, we're going to need to give the semantics of contexts. A table that gives you the values of all the variables in the context is called an environment. So we better figure out how to give an environment. If we know a context, backward list of types, then we should give some type that represents what an appropriate environment would be. Okay. There are lots of ways to do this. I'm just going to do it by recursion over the list. So that's the way I feel today. What we're going to want is a value for each variable, a value for each entry in the list. So if you're thinking, why not use something like all that we have from exercise 2, that's a good thought. I'm just going to do something which does the same job, but I'll compute it by recursion instead. What I basically compute is the type of a big tuple of values. So if the context is empty, then we don't need to know any values. So I can just give back 1 for the interpretation of the empty context. And then if the context says, T is our most local type, most local variable, this type T, and then the rest are given by T's, then we're going to need 2 things. We're going to need an environment that explains the rest of the variables, and we're going to need a value for the top one. So all we're doing is collecting in an environment a value for each variable, and it has to be a value that fits with that variable's type. Okay? So that means, I'm just going to delete that and start again, that we need an environment for the context, and then we've got some chance of interpreting a term for that context in some type T as a value in type T. Okay. So let's do that. I'm going to use V's as the variable for contexts. So now we've got some chance. Here we get a variable that is selecting from the context, and what we need to do now is to make use of the fact that we have an environment full of values for everything in the context. We just want to know one of them. Okay? So tell you what I'll do, we've seen this before as well. I'll write an operation called select, which says if we know that S's is a subcontext of T's, we can turn up an environment for all of the T's into an environment for just the S's. So I'm going to call that X, and this is going to be V's. Okay? And why is that going to be useful? Let's use it first, so then decide why we care about it later. If I say with select x from v's, what do I get? I get a pair, which is an environment for a context of length 1, which is the pair of 1 and a value of type t. So I'll split that pair. And then that's one of those. And that's a v. Okay, so I managed to grab my value out. And look, it's exactly the type we wanted. All right. So that's how you use select to interpret a variable as a choice from an environment. Now let's make sure we can actually write select. Okay, so what happens? We look at the thinning. If it's the thinning between empty contexts, you can see our the environment coming in is empty, but the environment going out is also empty. So we can pattern match like that just to show that we know that's empty. And otherwise, we know that we've got that our environment's definitely got something in it. So we can split that. Just doing it by hand. Okay, so here we've got the thinning says we want to keep the top one, and so we can just select from the rest and certainly give back the V. So the us is telling us that we want to keep this V, so we keep it. And in the other case, where the O apostrophe says we should drop the V, we drop it. So we're just interpreting the thinning as instructions for choosing stuff out of an environment. Okay, so that's the variables dealt with. Realize I'm type checking on battery power. Let's draw a command. If we're interpreting our object language constructor for the unit type, for the one type, well, we've got to give back a value in the one type, and we know what that is. If we're interpreting our object language constructor for nil, we better give back the meta language constructor for nil. If we've got so here we're doing a cons, and we've got sub-expressions. One says how to compute the head, one says how to compute the tail. So we're going to use our meta-language cons, the AGDA cons. And then here we've got to give a value of type t, and we can do that by evaluating the head of the list in the same environment. And here, that's amusing, it chose to give us nil, that's always good. Let's do that one by hand then. Yeah, we get the tail value by evaluating the tail expression. Now we have a fold where we have a case for cons and a case for nil and a list. Well, what would help is if I had the corresponding fold up. We're going to turn all the lists into AGDA lists and all the functions into AGDA functions. So the right piece of kit we need solve this problem, it's actually the AGDA definition of fold R. So let's do that. I better actually call it fold R L or something. So that was, if we've got an x to t to t and a t, we'll get a list of x to t. How does it work?
What should it not be our folds on backwards lists?
Well, I wrote, I put list here.
Yeah.
So I'm using backwards lists only for context. Okay, so here we give back the nil result, and here we give C applied to the head, and the result of the fold on C, N, and X's. Okay, so now I should be able to say that's just going to be given by meta language fold R, and now it says here, I'd like a list, please, and I'll get that by evaluating our list. And now here, we want a function from list values to, so from list elements to return values to return values. And if we're lucky, that's what we'll get if we evaluate C. And then we want the base case, which is just the return value, and we can get that by evaluating n. Okay, we're nearly there. We're supposed to evaluate a lambda, and that means it turns into an actual honest-to-goodness Agda function. Giving us an argument value coming in, expecting a result value coming out. We can write an honest to goodness Agda lambda to give that function. Okay, so now you can see we've got our input value and we just have to explain how to deliver the output value. Well, how do you think we deliver the output value of a lambda whose body is t? We're gonna have to evaluate t.
With the extra thing in the
context. Yeah, so we're being asked for an environment, an environment for the extended context, which consists exactly of an environment for all the things we knew about in the first place, together with a value for the variable that was just bound by the lambda. And that's exactly the thing we've just been handed. So here we just say that's V's paired with S. And we're in good shape. So finally, we've got to evaluate function application. And how do we do that? Well, if we evaluate the function, you can see we get an Agda function. So we can just apply that Agda function to something. And now we need a value of the input type. But we've got an expression of the input type, so we can just evaluate it as well. So there we have a situation where the programs guaranteed type safety and what was in scope, so we were able to say what environment would explain all the variables in scope, and we were able to explain why the programs would always produce a value, and because the expressions were well typed, we never had to deal with any situations where the bits and pieces didn't work properly. All we had to do was first give the semantics for the types of the object language, And then, once we know the translation of the types, all we had to do was translate all the constructs of the object language into their meta-language counterparts. So we turn, you know, object lambda into meta lambda, object application into meta application, all the way along. So that's how it goes. And if you think it looked suspiciously easy, don't be suspicious. It really is this easy. It's this easy because all of the discipline, all of the stuff that introduces complication, we got rid of when we wrote down the data type of not just any old rubbish, but terms which are guaranteed to make sense, right? We said what would make sense when we wrote this down, and then, gosh, it turned out that they did make sense. So we got paid for bothering to be precise. I can tell I'm going to want to run a program. I know I'm going to need this gadget, which says if you have an X in set and an X is in backward X, you know that the empty context is definitely a subcontext of any context you like. So you can see, this is the embedding for the empty context, and it just skips everything. So we'll be able to use that. The way we make a variable is to skip down to the variable we care about, keep that one, and then skip everything else. So I don't know. Let's write a program. Right. Let's even write append. So it should take. It should work in any context. But we should get a term in that context whose type is list t to list t to list t. And let's do it. Okay. So what happens? We can first of all get our inputs. So we say lambda, and you can see that the first input has moved into the context. And then we say lambda again, and the second input has moved into the context. Okay, and now we can say that we want to do fold R. I always find it's absolutely hilarious that Agda gives us. Did they have a fold R right? I haven't told it what fold R to do. It's absolutely hilarious that, in a sort of funny sort of a way, Agda gives you for free like interactive programming for the language you've just implemented. You can see that this goal is, if you squint at it hard enough, it's like an Agda goal display. It tells you what you know and what the type is that you're trying to make. We're playing the same game, one level down, and, which is fun. Okay, so the list we want to fold over is the first argument of the function. So that's let's do goal five. It's the first argument to the function, that's this one. So let's give a variable, and now we have to pick something. We know it's a list type, but we don't know what, from this context. And we said we wanted this one, so we'd better skip the top one, take the next one, and then skip the rest. So we're counting back into the context. This way of not naming variables is called de Brown indexing. It was invented in the 1960s by Nicholas de Brown, a Dutch computer scientist. It's sort of generally considered that de Brown indices are really unreadable for human beings, right? You're really saying, it's like, you know, why do we have names? Because it would be extremely, extremely awkward to refer to us by, you know, describing your position in the room, right? You know, that's much, much more convenient to have names. Instead of saying, you know, the person nearest the door, I say grey. You know, but they're extremely convenient for computers because they tell us exactly where in an environment we need to pick stuff out of. So providing some superficial support for human beings to call things by names is a good plan. But for building the actual core of the machine, this is really handy. Okay, let's keep moving. What do we give back in the nil case? Yeah, we're doing concatenation. So if the first argument is empty, we want to give back the second argument. So that's another variable. But this time it's the top one. So we grab the top one and skip the rest. And finally, we need to give a function that explains how to compute the recursive case. So we've got to give a function of this type. It takes a head and the thing we computed from the tail and gives back the whole thing. So what we want to do, again, we introduce the head and then the thing we computed from the what we computed from the tail, and now we have to give back a list, which I think we'll give back, as I can see time short, we'll give back with cons, and now I need to give back something of type T. I bet I can figure out what that is. No, we can't. Why is this insisting that I type the parentheses in for some reason? Okay, can we select a T from this bunch of stuff? I bet we can. Oh, I need to do that. Thank you for that. Those parens are not necessary. And otherwise, for the tail of the output, we want to give back the most locally bound thing. Okay, so it's 5 minutes to, but let's finish with a test, which is going to be a value of type list of one, and test is going to be given by evaling in the empty context, so we'll give the empty environment something. What's it? Oh, that should be eval of little list of little one. Okay, so now I need to give a term, and I'll give it as append of something and something. And now I need to give back two lists, and I'll make this one void cons nil, and I'll make this one void cons nil as well. So what I'm really doing is 1 plus 1. And back comes 2. So in the space of one lecture, we managed to write an evaluator for a programming language. The programming language was represented in a type-safe way. The evaluator had no failure cases. And then we wrote a tiny little program in that programming language, and we ran it. What fun we can have playing these games. Okay, better stop there. Cheers, folks. Have a great weekend.